Dr. Shabir, welcome to Let the Quran Speak.
It's my pleasure to be on.
Now, Dr. Shabir, 30% of people in the UK and in the US have reported that they're not sure if they're going to take the vaccine. And some people think that this number is actually underreported. In Canada, 1 in 5 people are saying they're not sure. How would you respond to this uncertainty and fear of the vaccine?
I think it's natural among common folk to have some hesitation with new medications, new vaccines, because we know that everything has some sort of side effect. And we know from experience that sometimes a drug is touted as the cure-all, and then we find out later, sometimes much later, that there are side effects which were not previously expected. So there's this natural hesitancy among some people. There is an article in Al Jazeera, the English version of Al Jazeera, showing that there are some people who are hesitant, especially in some ethnic communities, due to some long history of, they have some memory of many generations ago, experimental drugs being given to some of their ancestors, and people are very skeptical about, the medical establishment on the whole, mm-hmm. and how, people might be used as guinea pigs and so on. So all of these fears built in together can explain some of this hesitation among the common folks. But on the other hand, we have many good reasons for trusting science and trusting the medical establishments in our modern developed nations. Because in the developed nations, there are checks and balances. While scientists have a great degree of freedom to think, to explore, to study, and to develop things, at the same time, there are checks and balances. There are controls. In the United States, there's the Center for Disease Control. There's the Food and Drug Administration. In Canada, there is Health Canada. And we have seen that there were due process was followed both in the United States and in Canada. And I assume the same elsewhere in all of the modern developed countries, due process to ensure that before the governmental authorities can give the go-ahead for the new vaccine to be used, they have to be sure that this is safe for the population. So there's a great degree of responsibility here. This is not like Nazi Germany where, there is a deliberate attempt to kill off a large populace. This is a very concerted move to save the populace by people who feel this great burden of responsibility. And if we don't know what's in their minds, we know that there are checks and balances in our modern systems to ensure that nobody can abuse the populace by putting out a drug that will be so detrimental, as some people might be fearing. Mm-hmm.
Some people are fearful and they're saying, the vaccine came out so quickly. Usually it takes quite a while for vaccines, many years for vaccines to be developed. And in this case, it came out within months. So many people are expressing concern about that, if it's actually safe. How would you respond to that, Dr. Shabir?
Well, that concern comes from, again, our long history of knowing that it takes a long time to develop a vaccine. Like, for example, if we think about vaccines in the past, whether it be vaccines against measles or smallpox or whatever the case might be, we know that it normally takes a long time for vaccines to be produced, but we see that in our modern era, things are developing at rapid speed and exponentially so. So, what might have taken 5 years in the past may take 5 months in our present era, not only in developing vaccines, but whether it be cell phones or computers or a vast array of new developments, because we are building on the knowledge of what transpired previously. We have that stock of knowledge, and we are building upon that. We are going higher and we're going faster. So this is normal. The other aspect of this is that while you cannot speed up certain bioprocesses, but you can save time by having many of the processes done simultaneously. So you're not waiting for one to be done and then you're going to take more time to do the next phase, but you can do some things in parallel. So with that, plus the fact that this virus that we're dealing with now turned out to be a pandemic, it's gripped the entire world, it has set economies back, it has placed us all under a sort of a lockdown or semi-lockdown situation. So it was like all hands on deck. Everybody who had some stake in this, who had some ability to come forward and do something for the world, have been there working at it. And it's natural in that race to get it done that someone would come up with it in due time after all of the proper due diligence was done to make sure that it is safe and that it is ready in good order. On short order.
Officials are saying that it's not, you know, the safety that was curtailed. It's actually the bureaucratic process, the red tape, and the funding that was expedited. So safety is fine, but it's just that there was more impetus from government officials to speed this up, to speed up the whole process, to get it to people, to solve the COVID crisis that we are in right now.
And in Canada, we can understand, at least, I mean, I don't know so much about other countries, but in Canada, we can understand this part about government funding, because we see that the government is investing large sums of money to keep the economy going, to keep businesses alive, to help even nonprofit organizations and charities.
And to develop the vaccine as well.
Exactly. I mean, so, you know, not knowing the details of how the vaccine is being developed and the funding behind it, one can just see that the government is really interested in keeping people safe and getting people, you know, back on track with life returning to a state of as normal as possible.
In fact, scientists are saying that they were already developing this vaccine before COVID. So they were already working with this mRNA and they had plans to incorporate it into vaccine. And then when COVID came along, it seemed like this was the moment. So it wasn't like it just sort of started after COVID. They were developing it prior to that as well.
Yeah, you know more about that aspect than I do.
Dr. Shabir, I want to ask you, because some people are saying, are making all sorts of claims like the vaccine affects changes your DNA, things that are unscientific. What advice do you have for an individual who's thinking about whether they should take the vaccine or not? How should they parse through all the information that's available from reliable sources and unreliable sources? How can they make the right decision for themselves?
Well, you put it nicely by saying, you know, there are reliable sources and unreliable sources. If you go to unreliable sources, you can get all kinds of conspiracy theories about anything. I mean, there are people who believe that the Earth is flat, even to this day. So you can go to their websites and find, you know, their claims, and whatever they present will seem convincing if you don't know the subject. Of course, everybody knows that the Earth is spherical, well, except for the flat Earth society. And but those who hold to a certain conspiracy theory or an outlying theory, they will have some convincing case to present to persons who are not educated and who do not have the wherewithal to evaluate those arguments. So the best thing for most of us is just to go to reliable sources. How do we know who are reliable sources? Well, you know, there is a kind of a sieve that society creates to make sure that we are getting the reliable sort of experts and the reliable information from the experts. So one sieve is the university system. The university system is going to select people from a vast array of those who claim to know something. They're going to select the people who have the relevant qualifications from relevant and important and significant other universities. So it takes the scholars to approve other scholars, and then they get teaching positions at the universities. So that's a good source. Is the person telling you about the vaccine, is that person well-placed within the education traditional academic establishment, or is this somebody who just simply has to happen to have a blog? Because anybody can say anything on Twitter, on blog, on YouTube, and so on. But we need to get it from reliable sources. So is it coming from a reliable source such as Health Canada, which is a responsible body within Canada for disseminating this kind of information in the United States, Center for Disease Control, and the Food and Drug Administration, the reliable bodies to give this sort of information. The Mayo Clinic in the United States has put out an article, which you know about because you sent me the link. That's a very interesting article, and it quells many of the fears that people may have. It busts the myths about the vaccine that people may be bandying about. So that will be an interesting read for many people.
Dr. Shabir, very quickly before we end, I want to ask you about some Muslims who are expressing concern about science, especially the science regarding COVID. Can you speak about the relationship between Islam and science?
Well, it's like hand in hand. You were already doing that, and that got me. Yeah, it's hand in hand, like a glove. The Quran tells us to think, to reflect, to study, to examine. The Prophet Muhammad, on whom be peace, is reported to have told us that we should seek the cures, because he said, لِكُلِّ دَاءٍ دَوَاءٍ, for every disease there is a cure. And we just have to seek it, and God will give us the bounty of helping us to find the right solution.
Thank you, Dr. Shabir, for
your answer. You're welcome.
If you enjoyed this video, click like and subscribe. And please donate to support our work at QuranSpeaks.com.